West Phoenix, let's all stand and sing about the amazing grace that God has given to us.
Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are thankful for your amazing grace, for your amazing love, and for demonstrating your love to us when you came to this earth and you died on the cross for our sins so that we could have eternal life if we just place our faith and trust in you. We thank you for this church and just for the love that we can share together in unity and the service that we can share in furthering your kingdom and investing in your kingdom. And so, Father, I pray that you'll continue to bless this church. You'll use us in a tremendous way to reach people for Christ in this community and even outside of this community. I pray that you will continue to bless every part of this church and our lives. I pray right now that as we worship you, as we listen to your word, that we would draw closer to you, that we would understand your power, your might, that we would experience your presence in our lives at this moment, and that we would rejoice, and that we would be content in whatever we face in life, in the trials and different things that we go through. I pray, God, that you would just give us that joy in our lives, no matter what happens in life, and that we'll continue serving you, that we would continue to experience the joy of our salvation. So, Father, right now, I pray that you'll bless this service, that you'll speak to each and every heart, that you'll minister to each and every one of us as we bring glory to you and as we draw closer to you and give you control over our lives and of this service. So, Father, thank you for this time that we can spend together with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Come. just become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, your presence. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, grace, where burden turns to wonder. To throw my life a river into the triumph of the sun. I know your love has won it all. You took the fall to embrace my sorrows. I know. And your mercy, heaven walked a broken road.
Thank you, praise team. So good to see all of you here this morning, and today's a special day because Butch and Kathy are getting married this afternoon at 4 o'clock, and wanted to, and of course, Butch and Kathy want to invite all of you. They hope that all of you will be able to make it at 4 o'clock, and that's when they'll be getting married. So we're looking forward to that. I don't have many announcements in the bulletin, but I did want to mention to you that Joyce Patterson's funeral will be this Saturday at the Rest Haven. At 9 o'clock, that's her. The service will be at 9, and then the viewing will be at 8 o'clock, and that's off of I believe 63rd Avenue and Northern. And so that's this Saturday. We also want to pray for Mark Fish's mom passed away, and so we want to pray for him and his family as they grieve the loss of his mom, and so. He appreciates our prayers, and I texted him. And also, Betty James, I went to see her this past week, and she was in the hospital. She fell again, but she's doing fine now. She's back in her group home, and she wishes she could come out more, but it's hard for her. She's very weak, and so we need to continue praying for her as well. And so we just keep praying, always check your prayer list. And so that will give you all the information. Anything that didn't make it into the prayer list, I'll try to mention on Sunday mornings here. But it's good to see everyone this morning. And we've been praying for Sandra, and she's here. And it's so good to see you, and we love you. And we're glad that you're back. And boy, I'll tell you, she's been through a lot, but she's a trooper. And God has certainly answered our prayers to bring her back to us, and so we love you. And also, my nephew Matthew White is here, and that's good to see Matthew. He works for NASA in Houston, and I guess there's no space shuttle going up today or anything like that. That's good. He takes care of all the oxygen for those astronauts that go up, and so we're glad he gets to take a break here. And let's see, also, Glenn and Joe are here, and we love you guys. I'm so glad that you're here. And anyone else here for the first time in a long time, you're our special guest, And we want to recognize you. Yes, hi. It's good to see you. Thank you for coming out. Great. Awesome. Anyone else? Good to see Margaret back. We've been praying for you as well. And so we're so glad that you're back, Margaret. We love you. And let's welcome Margaret back.
All right, let's bring it back to our seats. And we came to glorify the Lord. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify the name of the Lord. I came to glorify His name. Whoso offereth praise, glorify it me. Whoso offereth praise, glorify it me. Salvation of God. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify the name of the Lord. I came to glorify His name. Whoso offereth praise, glorify it me. Whoso offereth praise, glorify in me. And to Him that ordereth this conversation aright, will I show the salvation of God. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify the name of the Lord. I came to glorify. Come on, let's hear it. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify His name. I came to glorify the name of the Lord. I came to glorify His name. By the name of the Lord.
Father, we love You, we worship and adore You.
concerns me today. He is able, more than able, to handle anything that comes my way. He is able, more than able, to do much more than I could ever dream. He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. He is able, more than able, to handle anything that comes my way.
Piano.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Big day today. Big, big day. We've all been looking forward to this big day. Let me tell you, we all have good days, and then we also have some sad days. And tomorrow is the anniversary, my 10-year anniversary of being diagnosed with MS. And God has definitely been there for me, but this song has always comforted me, and when I heard about Mark's mom passing away, I couldn't help but think that she had MS. You know, she fought real hard for, you know, 8 years battle, but unfortunately she had a very progressive type. But this song, I think, is I'm going to dedicate it to Mark and his family, and just to remind them that God does care for us, he's concerned for us, and he gets us through those sad times, and is with us when we celebrate the happy times too. So this is called He's Concerned.
God is just a prayer away. All you need to do is call. He will hear your faintest cry. He's concerned about you. So while your tears are flowing through your time of mourning, He is here to lift your heavy heart. He's in love with you. He knows, He cares, He sees, He's there. And He'll carry you. He's concerned about you. Weeping may endure for a night, but the morning will bring joy. He won't give you more than you can bear. He's concerned about you. He loves you, oh yeah. He loves you. Oh, yes, He does. He really does. He's concerned about you. He knows, He cares, He sees, and He's right there. And concerned about you. Well, He knows and He cares. He sees and He's right there, and He'll carry you. He's concerned about you. is concerned about you. He's concerned about you.
Let's pray together, shall we? Father in heaven, we thank you for always being there for us. Through all the trials and suffering and things that we face, and that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And so, Father, thank you for your unfailing love, that you love us even when we're unlovable. And so, Father, I pray that you'll just right now touch us with your word, the scriptures, as we look into it right now. Help us to be not only hearers of the word, but doers as well, and that we would take your word to heart, that we would see a lot of value, great value in your word and in knowing you better. And so, Father, thank you so much for just for always being there for us, no matter what. And I pray that you'll fill me with your spirit, that every word that comes out of my mouth will come directly from you. Pray that you'll bless your word and put it in our hearts right now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Three clergymen split on a lottery ticket, and they actually won the grand prize. They won $1 million, and the Baptist minister was wondering how much they should give God and how much they should keep to themselves. And so he thought for a moment. He said, you know what, I think what we should do is maybe draw a circle on the ground, and any money that falls inside the circle, we give to God, and any money that falls outside the circle, we keep to ourselves. We just throw the money up in the air. It falls in the middle, God gets that whatever's in the middle, and then we'll just take whatever's on the outside the circle. The priest said, well, sounds like a good idea, but you know, it's a little windy out. So I think that maybe we should give God the money that falls on the outside of the circle, and we'll keep the money on the inside. Well, they turned to the rabbi. They asked the rabbi, what do you think we ought to do? And the rabbi said, well, I think that we ought to just throw the money up in the air, and whatever God wants to keep, we'll keep, and whatever falls to the ground, we'll just keep. I want to ask you this morning, how much of your life are you willing to give to God? How much of your life are you willing to invest in the kingdom of God? How much of your life are you willing to give to God? Romans 12, 1 and 2 says, I beseech you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might know what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. You see, God just doesn't want part of us. Think about the Christian life. What is the Christian life all about? Is living the Christian life about just coming to church on Sunday and maybe on Wednesday night? Maybe giving 10% of our money to the Lord? What is the Christian life about? Yes, we all know, those of us know that as Christians, that when we accept Christ as our personal Savior, yeah, we know what it's going to be like when we die. We're going to heaven. Praise the Lord for that. We know where we're going when we die. But what about right now? What happens to us now? How should we live our lives? Well, the Bible gives us instructions on how we should live our lives on a daily basis. But Christians, most Christians in the world, have no idea really what God wants them to do in life, or how God wants us to live as Christians. It's not just about coming to church on Sunday mornings and sitting in the chair, listening to the sermon and singing praises to God. That's a very, very small part of it. According to this verses that I read in Romans chapter 12, it's all about giving your entire body, everything to the Lord. Hello? God's speaking to us right now, right? I'll tell you what, that's a message from God, and God's saying, right on. Just God's just saying amen to that one, right? God wants all of us. He wants our cell phones. He wants every part of us, and he calls us, not on our phone, but he calls us every day to follow him. And he's speaking to us right now because God has this message for us. And God's saying to us, hey, this is how I want you to live. This is what the Christian life is about. It's not just coming and sitting in a chair on Sunday mornings. There's a much more to that. I want all of you. I just don't want 10% of your tithe, your money. I want all of your money. You see? I mean, God has given them, it's God's money. God gave us a job. God gave us the money. And he just wants us to manage his money. And so whatever God wants us to give, whether it be a 10% or 20% or 50%, it's all his. And we need to give it. Whatever God tells us to give. Because, hey, you know what, Mason? I want more this week than your 10%. I just want more this week because the church needs it. All right, well, I have to just write the check out for more. I mean, that's just the way God is. And God wants our ears, what we hear. God wants our mouths. God wants our hands and our feet. And every place we go, God should be in control of our lives. He wants a total surrender. He wants us to use our gifts and talents to serve him. The Christian life is about serving. When we come to church, we come to serve. Whether it be in the nursery or the children's program, or whether it be up here as singing, leading in worship, or taking the offering, or making phone calls during the week like Ruby does, and those on the prayer chain do, and praying and throughout the week, and being involved with the daily workings of the church, like so many of you do. And you see, the Christian life is a full-time job. God didn't make you and create you on the earth just to be a carpenter or a teacher. That's an occupation that God uses in your life to reach people for Christ. You say, well, I can't share my faith at school or at work, but you can be a testimony. And people can see Christ in you. They should be able to see Christ in you, the way you live, and the way you talk, and the way you help, and the way you serve, and how committed you are to your church. That's what the Christian life is all about. We sing, I surrender all. I surrender some of my money. I surrender some of my time. Sundays and Wednesdays, I surrender some of my life. You know, if we're honest with God, God knows, that's what the song would sound like if we were actually honestly singing that song, you know. Well, yeah, I'll give God Sundays and Wednesdays, but you know, I mean, Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, Friday, Saturday, you know. I mean, God wants all of us. Now, most of the time when you hear preachers preach a sermon like this, you know, they put people on a guilt trip. You know, preachers guilt people into serving more and giving more and being more like Jesus. Well, I want you to know I'm not going to do that because I don't think it works. I've sat through many sermons that where preachers would put you on a guilt trip and you say, oh, boy, you know. And so you get to work for, you know, a few weeks and you think you're doing good, but then it falls apart and then you're all disappointed with yourself and you're depressed. You say it's impossible to live the Christian life. And so I'm not going to do that. But what I want us to consider is our values. Because life is all about our values. If God is important to you, if God is valuable to you, if God's word is important to you, this is the most important book in your life, then you're going to read it. If it's important to you. So life is all about values, and every decision that we make in life is based on our values. Think about it. It really is. What we do with our money. We're going to give our money to our kids or people that are important to us. Things that we value. We're going to do things for people that we value and that are important to us. And years ago, researchers posed a question to ordinary Americans for a book that they were working on entitled, and many of you have heard this, book, The Day America Told the Truth. They asked this question: what would you do for $10 million? 25% said that they would leave their families. 25% said that they would leave their church and or religion. 23% said that they would be a prostitute for a week or more for $10 million. 7% said that they were willing to kill a stranger for $10 million. Now, after the survey was taken, the researchers wondered if $10 million, that's the same people, what would you do for $5 million, $4 million, and $3 million? Guess what? Their responses were the same. But I have good news for you, because the good news is that for $2 million, people started having second thoughts. Isn't that wonderful? Okay. I don't know if I'm going to kill a stranger for $2 million. That's, you know. Money talks. Money is important to people. Many people value money more than anything else. Economist John Kenneth Galbraith said, money ranks with love as man's greatest joy and ranks with death as his greatest source of anxiety. The Bible expresses more serious insights to the love of money by saying, you know the verse, 1 Timothy 6:10, that the love of money is the root of all evil. The love of money. People love money more than God. Joshua 24:15 says, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. How about you? Can you say that about you and your family? One night, a group of thieves broke in a jewelry store. They didn't steal anything. Instead, they just changed the price tags on each one of the jewelry. So the next day, no one could tell what was valuable and what was cheap. The expensive jewels had suddenly become cheap, and the costume jewelry, which had been virtually worthless before, was suddenly of great value. Customers who thought that they were purchasing valuable gems were walking out with fakes. And those who couldn't afford the higher priced items were leaving the stores with treasures. Well, I want you to know that in the world, someone came along and changed the price tags. It's hard to tell what's of great value and what's not of great value. Great value is given to the accumulation of material wealth and power that goes along with it. The world puts a high price on popularity, prestige, beauty, and fame. But Jesus taught that such things were virtually worthless. And the only jewelry store that matters is the kingdom of God. Matthew 6:19-20 says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on the earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourself treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. You see, we don't focus on things that people can steal. We don't focus on things of the world. We focus on the eternal, not the temporal. We have a tendency to love those things which are only temporary, instead of those things which are eternal. Now listen, folks, I've been at the bedside of many, many people who have passed on and gone to heaven. And I will tell you, I can promise you this, that when you're on your deathbed, there's only going to be three things that are going to matter to you. There will only be three things that matter in life: who loves you, who you love, and what you've done for Christ. That's a promise to you. Those are the only things that are going to matter in life: who you love, who loves you, and what you've done for Christ. Not your past job, not the money that you've accumulated, not your big house. Nothing else is going to matter. Not the awards that you have on the wall, not your degrees. Nothing else will matter in life except for those three things. And let me ask you, what have you done for God in your life? Mickey Mantle, you all know Mickey Mantle, one of the greatest baseball players ever to live. And Mickey Mantle played for the New York Yankees, center fielder, years ago, and a member of the Hall of Fame. But he said just before he died that he squandered a gifted life and warned admirers that he was no role model. He died of cancer because of alcohol abuse. He said, God gave me the ability to play baseball. God gave me everything. For kids out there, don't be like me. In other words, don't waste your life indulging yourself in the sinful pleasures of life. The consequences are just not worth it. Just not worth it. Do you value your relationship with God? Be honest with yourself. Nobody else here has to know your answer, but do you value, how much do you value your relationship with God? Are you interested in spiritual things? When pleasure, material possessions, popularity become more important than God and His Word, that's when we fall into sin. If you don't want your children to have sex before marriage, teach them to love God more than they love pleasure. If you want your children to say no to drugs, teach them to love God more than they do their peers. You see, where do children get their sense of values? Where do children get their sense of values? When you give your child a dime for the offering plate, but you give them $1 or $2 for an ice cream or a Coke, you're showing your sense of values to your child. When you insist that your child does public homework, but then you complain if the church gives them a verse to memorize or some scripture reading to read, you complain about it, you're showing your sense of values to your child. When you stay at home and putter around the house instead of going to Sunday school and church, you're showing your sense of values to your child. When you insist that your child go to public school, they get in trouble if they don't, but don't insist that they go to Sunday school or church, something's wrong there. You're showing your sense of values to your child. When you put football or other things, other events ahead of your duties and responsibilities to the church, you're showing your sense of values to your child, you see. Now, football season's coming up, folks. And I know that's tough. Because honestly, I have friends and that are not a part of this church, but I do have Christian friends who will not come to church during football season. There's just no way. They will not come to church during football season. You know, the football season to them is Sundays are for family and friends to come over and barbecue. And the football games start early. And so it's an all-day thing. And if they come to church, that'll kind of, you know, that half the day is gone. And then you won't have time to clean the house and set up and barbecue and all that kind of stuff. And so you're just going to stay home. If you can't find a service on Saturday night, you're not going to go to church. And that's just the way some Christians are. But you know what? I was thinking about this because, you know, we have our smartphones now. And, you know, you can bring your smartphones to church, you know, and you can just check your smartphones to see the scores during in between songs. And then when we pray, we can kind of like bow our heads, you know, pretend we're praying. And we look down at the scores and kind of look through. And you can even shout out an amen if your team is winning. And nobody will know the difference. I'm being facetious, you know that. But the fact of the matter is people love football, and that's great. Football's great. And I have nothing against football, but what matters more to you, church, God, or football? You can do both. You can do both. And I once heard of a child who let out a frightful cry because he had stuck his hand in a very valuable Chinese vase. And and the mom and dad were trying to pull his hand out of the vase and couldn't get it out, and it was stuck. In fact, they called on the neighbors to try to help get this boy's hand, their son's hand, out of this expensive vase. He couldn't get it out, and so finally, unfortunately, they had to break the vase to get his hand out of the vase. But when the pieces fell on the ground, they understood why they were not able to get the boy's hand out of the vase. You see, the boy earlier spied a penny in the bottom of the vase. He reached in the vase to get the penny, and he grabbed it with his fist, and so he wouldn't let go of the penny in order to slide his hand back out. He just kept his hand in the fist. He wouldn't let go of that penny. People's values are all screwed up today. They're just like that child, reaching for the penny while not caring about breaking something of much more value in the process. Homes are being broken while moms and dads reach for a one-night pleasure or the love of another person. People work themselves to death while children and the church are being neglected. How important to you is your relationship with God? How important is it for you to know God? If it's important for you to know God, then why don't you study the Word of God? Because that's where we know God. Do you study His Word? I don't just mean bring your Bible to church on Sunday. We're talking about all week long. How much time do you spend in God's Word? A story is told of a man who loved books. And he met an acquaintance who had just thrown away a Bible that had been stored in the attic of his ancestral home for generations. And this friend said, I couldn't read the book. Somebody by the name of Guten something printed it. And the book lover said, not Gutenberg. That Bible was one of the first books ever printed. Why, a copy of that Bible just sold for over $2 million. And the friend says, you know what, my Bible wouldn't have brought even a dollar because some guy by the name of Martin Luther just scribbled all over the words in German. Of course, Martin Luther was the founder of the Lutheran denomination back in the early 1500s. The Word of God is important. If we want to know God, we've got to know His Word. In fact, 2 Timothy 3:16 says all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. You cannot know God very well without a deep study of God's Word. You cannot. You cannot know God's will without really digging in to the Word of God and studying the Word of God. You cannot know God's plans for your life. You cannot live a mature Christian life without studying faithfully the Word of God every day of our life. The Word of God is important. If we want to know God, we've got to know His Word. How much time do you spend reading His Word? Turn in your Bibles to Psalm 119:37. There's just a couple verses I want us to look at. Psalm 119:37. I ran across this verse in my study. Psalm 119. We probably should memorize this verse. Some of us need to write out these words on a big index card and probably put this word, this verse, like maybe on our TV or something, or maybe on some books or magazines. That might be a good idea. Just put it right there on your TV, right there, big letters. Psalm 119:37 says, turn my eyes from looking at worthless things. You know, wouldn't that be great if we just kind of put that on our TV set, on some of our books and some of our magazines? Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me life in your ways. Wouldn't that be a good verse to put on our TV or something? A man was out shopping with his wife, and a beautiful woman walked by, and he just stared at her. And of course, the wife, after the guy just couldn't take his eyes off of her, his wife says, was it worth all the trouble that you're in? Sometimes we need to ask ourselves that about other things that we look at. Is it worth all the trouble that we're in? Two boys were bragging about their dad, and one boy said, my dad makes more money than your dad. Another boy said, oh yeah, well my dad can run faster than your dad. The other boy said, oh yeah, well my dad can beat up your dad. And the other boy said, well yeah, well that's not saying much because my mom can beat up my dad. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 9 now. Jeremiah chapter 9. Jeremiah chapter 9. Verse 23 and 24. God says that there's only one thing worth bragging about, and that's do you know him? The only thing worth bragging about in life is, do you know Jesus Christ? Look what it says in Jeremiah 9, 23. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts, boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. It's amazing how we can brag about so many things. But God says that if you really want something to shout about, can you brag that you know him? Because if you can't brag about knowing God, if you can't talk about that, then it doesn't matter how much money you have, what's in your account, what degrees you have on the wall, what position you have in your company. It's just not worth it. Tony Evans says in his book, Time to Get Serious, if God is the all-consuming, all-powerful, all-knowing, loving, and infinite creator, sustainer, and redeemer of this universe, then nothing else we can do matters quite as much as getting to know him and to him well, and getting to know him well. And then in Philippians 3, verses 8 to 11, I'll just read them, and you can look it up later. But it's what the Apostle Paul says this, indeed, I count everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes from faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him, the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. You see, nothing else was more important to the Apostle Paul than knowing Jesus Christ. Everything else he counted loss, rubbish, garbage, compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ. Now, let me ask you one more question. If you could become any one of these four people, which one of these four people would you want to be? Number one, the richest, most successful businessman in the world. That's number one. Number two, or the most popular, most attractive movie star in the world. That's number two. Or the president of the United States. Or a poor orphan boy in Africa. Which one of those four, if you could choose any one of those four, which one of those four people would you hope to be? The richest, most successful businessman in the world, the most popular, most attractive movie star in the world, or the president of the United States, or a poor orphan boy from Africa? Well, some of you may have a hard time deciding between one, two, and three, but most people would not pick number four, a poor orphan boy in Africa. But let me, let me pose the question a little bit different for you, okay? You have the same four choices, except if you choose one, two, and three, you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. But if you're a poor orphan boy from Africa, you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Now, which one of the four would you want to be? The richest, most successful businessman in the world? The most popular, most attractive movie star in the world? Or the president of the United States? Or a poor orphan boy in Africa? Which one would you pick? And don't give me this that, you know, well, you know, I'll probably accept the Lord if I'm the richest. No, no. Okay? You're not a Christian. Nor will you ever be. Okay? A poor orphan boy from Africa is the Christian. Now, which one of the four would you want to be? You see what I'm asking here? How much is Jesus worth? Is that choice hard for you to make? Is knowing him worth more than all of Bill Gates' fortune? Is knowing him worth more than all the fame or power of a movie star or the power of the President of the United States? Now, in closing, I want us to think about computers. Almost all computers look the same on the outside. You know, you got the box and you got the screen and the mouse, and they all kind of look the same, but some cost a whole lot more than others. What's the difference? The difference is what's on the inside. It's the power, it's the guts of the computer, it's the memory, it's the processor, it's what's on the inside that dictates the price or the worth of the computer. But you know what? It's the same thing with us. It's what's on the inside of us that dictates our worth. And if you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior, then you're worth a great deal. You're very valuable because Jesus Christ is living in us. And God don't make no junk, you see. We are of great value only because Jesus Christ lives in our heart. The question is, do you know him? The question is, if you know him, are you serving him? Are you living your life for him? How valuable is Jesus Christ to you and your relationship? How valuable is a relationship with Jesus Christ? How valuable to you is his word in your life? Let's bow for prayer. There's a saying that I learned in Spanish. Vale la pena. Vale la pena. It's worth it. It's worth it. Jesus Christ is worth it. Knowing him is worth it. It's the only thing that's worth living for. Do you know him? Are you living for him? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you with humbled hearts this morning because all of us have fallen short of living our lives for you, of surrendering our all to you. So, Father, I pray that each one of us would make a decision, a heart-wrenching decision, to commit our lives to you and what it means to live the Christian life in service for you, using our gifts and talents that you've given us to serve you in your church. I pray, God, that we would turn to you. Forgive us of our sins of being lax in living the Christian life the way you want us to live. Help us to be more devoted in serving you, in maturing in our relationship with you. Thank you, Lord, for your word, what it means to each and every one of us, and for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, God has called you. This message is for each one of us, and we need to respond to his word. What is God calling you to do right now? What's your response going to be? Are you going to surrender your all to him? Are you going to give yourself to the Lord? Are you going to be more devoted to him? You're going to serve him. We have all kinds of places where we need people to serve, especially in the children's department and the preschool. We need you. God needs you. Don't just let that go. Will you come? God is calling you. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, come. You can accept him into your life right here, right now, in this very place. And you can leave this place a changed person, a new beginning, a fresh start with Jesus in your heart. If you already know Jesus Christ, what about your commitment to him, your dedication? The greatest life that you can live is living your life for him. Will you come? Can you sing, I Surrender All?
I surrender all.
Can you say that? All to Jesus, I surrender. Let's join hands and let's sing our closing chorus.
Father, thank you for blessing America. Thank you for this land of freedom. And now thank you for this message we hear today, the message of commitment from your word. Let us write these words on our minds and our hearts, and let us be a great testimony for you throughout the week, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And now, Father, take us home safely in Jesus' name. Amen.